Assalamu alaikum and welcome to this week's episode of Your Local Jummah. In this series, the Islam Channel team visits a masjid on the day of Jummah to film the khutbah and gather exclusive footage and interviews that we share to you, our audience, for your viewing pleasure. This week, we are fortunate to visit the Wembley Muslim Centre. That is a community centre that is used to host the 5 daily prayers and is actively used to host the Jummah prayers on Friday. The spaces are limited to 150 to 180 Muslims with a one-way entrance with the prayer area located up the stairs on the first floor. Imam Dr. Salman Butt shall be doing the khutbah to do with Islamophobia awareness and how to best address this topic and what to do should you face such a scenario.
Dear brothers and sisters, as many of us know, it's November, and in November many Muslim organizations around the country, they come together to remind people about one thing: Islamophobia Awareness Month. Islamophobia Awareness Month. And I just remembered this morning, I was looking over some old notes, and I found notes from Islamophobia Awareness Month 2014, 10 years ago. And I thought, I wonder what or how the situation of our brothers and sisters, our situation here and abroad even in terms of Islamophobia has changed in the last 10 years. And we see some good signs of a positive trajectory. The Muslim community compared to 10 years ago, just in my anecdotal experience, is far more confident, alhamdulillah. Our younger brothers and sisters that were born and they grew up after the war on terror era, they grew up with a different sense of confidence. They don't take any rubbish from anyone. We saw our brothers and sisters in the US in the election this week, Donald Trump's election victory. I was listening to a friend of mine, he is an imam in the US. He said there was a huge campaign to abandon the genocidal the participants for the genocide in the form of Kamala Harris, in the form of the Democratic Party. Even if it meant getting someone who is an unsavory figure, they said, we regard ourselves as the hand that is protecting the Ummah. They're protecting the Ummah from somebody stabbing it. Yes, the hand will get damaged. But our brothers and sisters in Gaza, who were subjected to genocide, if it means getting someone who might have unfavorable policies towards us, to punish those who are providing weapons, to punish those who are providing diplomatic support, to punish those who are providing narrative cover to the genocide of our brothers and sisters in Gaza, they said, we don't mind harming ourselves in the hand if it means putting the knife in the way that is attacking our innocent brothers and sisters in Gaza, for example. And they said something very interesting, and they made me proud of our brothers and sisters, of the new generation we see. They said, after 9/11, during the war on terror, many Muslims felt that they had to display themselves as the quote-unquote model minority. That we are very nice, we are law-abiding citizens, we don't rock the boat, we follow orders, we follow instructions. And naturally, not to mock them or anything, but this was a palpable feeling that people feel, Muslims felt that they were under attack, they had to show non-Muslims. They had to show sometimes oppressive authorities that, look, we're not a threat. We're nice. Islam is peace. But they said this didn't stop a genocide happening. This didn't stop our community being surveilled and spied on and people being picked up and put into prison for sometimes 20 years without due process, without proper charges, without accountability. So they said, no more Mr. Nice Guy. This abandoned Biden campaign that was turned on into the Abandon Harris campaign, they said, we are not waiting for anyone to show us dignity, to give us respect. We will stand up and take it ourselves. This young generation, alhamdulillah, even imams and du'at, they said, we are not waiting for anyone to come and save us. We are building our own power. We will hold people account who carry out genocide or support genocide. We will hold people to account who carry out structural or fuel structural racism and Islamophobia. And this made me proud, alhamdulillah, of our brothers and sisters, not just there, but also here. We saw in our election we had, Muslims are standing up on their own two feet. Muslims are showing that they have political or they have political threats that they can make good on. If somebody is spreading injustice, if somebody is spreading or supporting genocide, if somebody is a racist, for example, an Islamophobe, we won't just be quiet, but we will stand up against them, we will campaign against them, we will punish genocide, as we showed in our election here a few months ago. And alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah, this is a milestone in a good, overall good, positive trajectory, and Allah knows best. Only Allah knows what the future is going to hold. But this feeling, I felt this is palpably different from Islamophobia Awareness Month 10 years ago, when there was so much going on. Muslims felt, especially I was involved in some cases around the university dawah scene, your students felt the brunt of Islamophobia on campus. They felt that the Islamic society had to jump through all of these hoops to invite someone, anyone else that could just invite speakers, for example, all these types of things. But now I see, the more I speak to young people, the more I speak to even older people, they have that level of confidence and maturity. But it's not all rosy, because some things have gotten worse, arguably. The state of the Ummah, in terms of the strength, the confidence of our brothers and sisters, is better, alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah. But certain examples, like the genocide happening, for example, like every norm of war and armed conflict, international law being completely overturned one after the other, first in Syria, then our brothers and sisters in East Turkestan, now Uyghur brothers and sisters on occupied China, East Turkestan occupied by China, and now obviously our brothers and sisters in Gaza, we see our brothers and sisters in India being attacked by Hindutva mobs, for example. These things on a micro level, when you zoom in, yes, it looks like they're getting worse, but they are a symptom. They're a symptom, they are growing pains of an ummah coming to terms with its identity, coming to terms with getting more and more awake, more and more alive, getting up to the position where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants it to be. Kuntum khayru ummatin ukhrijat linnas. You're the best nation raised for mankind. Why? Because of your ethnicity? Because of... No, nothing to do with that. Because ta'muruna bil ma'ruf wa tanhauna 'anil munkar wa tu'minuna billah. You enjoin what is good, you forbid what is evil, while you are believers in Allah. When you do this, Allah wants you to be at this level of ummah. When you do this, you're going to get some backlash. You're going to get some backlash. There's going to be some friction. The Prophet ﷺ went overnight from As-Sadiqul Amin, the trustworthy, the truthful one, the one that everyone loved. Overnight, he turned into the enemy of the state. Why? Because he began to call people towards good. He began to speak out against injustice. He began to be a thorn in the side of those people. And this is what Islamophobia really is. Islamophobia is not a rejection of Islam. Islamophobia is rooted in racism. It's rooted in oppression. It's an irrational fear. And the Quran, subhanAllah, anything you want to, any guidance you want to get from it, you will get that guidance. If you read the Quran, if you reflect over the Quran for lessons to be a good father, you will get those lessons. You will see those stories in that light. If you want to read, recite the Quran to make you a better worshipper, make you glorify Allah more, you will get those lessons from the Quran. And if you read the Quran, if you reflect over the Quran, if we reflect over the Quran, looking for guidance when it comes to Islamophobia, oppression, racism, we will see that. We will get those lessons. أولئك الذين هداهم الله فبهداهم اقتده. Allah says about the prophets, those are the ones that Allah guided. So when it comes to their guidance, follow it. We see in the prophets' stories, not only were they calling people to Allah جل وعلا, not only were they shunning or calling people against shirk, they were calling people towards justice. They were speaking out against injustice. There's a soft secularism that some people are portraying where they say, no, all they're talking about is some spiritual things, or all they're talking about is theology or aqidah or this or that. No, they came with the entire package. We all know the story of Musa alayhi salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا مُوسَى بِآيَاتِنَا وَسُلْطَانٍ مُبِينٍ. We sent Musa alayhi salam, we certainly sent Moses with our signs, our miracles, and a clear mandate and a clear authority. To whom? إِلَى فِرْعَوْنَ وَهَامَانَ وَقَارُونَ فَقَالُوا سَاحِرٌ كَذَّابٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said He sent them to three types of people. Pay attention to each of these. They are an archetype. Wherever you see oppression, yesterday, today, forever, you'll likely see these three types of people. He sent them to Fir'aun. Fir'aun, the person drunk on power, the supremacist, the one who feels he claims to be a god, claims to be something worthy of veneration, worship, and obedience. Haman, representing what, as the Mufassirin say, representing the people that get things done, the political elites, the wazirs, the administrators, the people that the Fir'aun relies on to execute his evil plans. And Qarun, we know, it's a very interesting one. Qarun is the archetype of what? The person who let wealth get to his head. Ill-gotten wealth, bankrolling, the oppression. But Qarun has an interesting other side to his story. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ قَارُونَ كَانَ مِنْ قَوْمِ مُوسَى فَبَغَى عَلَيْهِمْ. Qarun was from the people of Musa alayhi salam. The Sahaba said he was actually the cousin of Musa alayhi salam, but he betrayed them. So Qarun also has this element of being one of Banu Israel, but he betrayed them. He sided with Fir'aun. He was enriched. He used his wealth against his own people. And we all see this. We all know, we're all nodding our heads. We see this time and time and again. Anyone who studies human beings, if they study oppression, they always see this native collaborator, the sellout, the Uncle Tom, the as Malcolm X put it, rahimahullah. That there's often some people who betray their own people in order to get ahead, to carry favor with the oppressors. But we see these types of people, we see the Quran telling us, warning us about these types of people. But look at the story of Musa alayhi salam. We all know he was raised in the palace of Fir'aun because of the policy Fir'aun put in place to kill all the firstborn, or all the sons of Banu Israel 1 year and spare them the other year. Because what? He saw a dream that a fire coming from the land of Palestine came to consume them. And they saw this as someone from that tribe, Banu Israel, is going to get rid of him. And subhanAllah, the people in the land of Palestine, the very descendants of these people, our brothers and sisters, our Palestinian brothers and sisters, again, have acted like a fire that has awoken, that has spread all across the world and gotten rid of tyrants and punished tyrants, like we said only a moment ago, for their role in supporting the Fir'auns of today, the pharaohs of today.
We were able to do multiple interviews at the Wembley Muslim Centre to get a better idea of how this community centre enables the people of Wembley to not miss out on their prayers and spread the message of Islam.
So today we talked about Islamophobia. It's Islamophobia Awareness Month. I think hopefully a lot of brothers and sisters around the country will be recalling that. Some, a few important messages, looking at the Quran, what we can learn about Islamophobia, racism, oppression, particularly from the story of Musa alayhi salam and Pharaoh, you know, the archetypal kind of Islamophobe, racist, oppression, subjugation, that kind of stuff. And we see, I saw some notes from 10 years ago, Islamophobia Awareness Month 10 years ago, and I was just reflecting the difference. You know, in some regards, the Muslim community has gotten much more confident. We see them, for example, punishing, you know, pro-genocide politicians in the UK elections and now in the US as well, alhamdulillah. The Muslims are becoming much more confident, the new generation, alhamdulillah. There's also some challenges, many challenges, you know, obviously genocide, kind of oppression we see from Syria, from East Turkestan to obviously Gaza, genocide happening across the world. All norms of kind of warfare being flouted,
against defenseless populations, but it's got challenges for us to rise up to, and we have the example of the prophets and the messengers. Not only did they call people to Tawheed, but they called people to justice and spoke out against injustice. So that's key to our message and our da'wah as well, inshallah. So in terms of Islamophobia Awareness Month, there's three very simple messages for the community. Number one, report Islamophobia where you experience it, where you see it. Not because you feel like a victim or subjugated, but because it's important for statistics, it's important for making an argument on a national level. Number two, get involved in Islamophobia Awareness Month in terms of exhibitions, something at your school, college, workplace. Number three, be involved in challenging Islamophobia, for example, online and in the media, writing complaints to Ofcom or editors or newspapers when it comes to Islamophobic or racist kind of headlines and these and stories and framing. And also, importantly, commending those journalists that are doing a good job in the media. You know, we have to balance it out as well. So giving positive and negative reinforcement. And that, in a nutshell, that was the message today.
Assalamu alaikum. I come here quite a lot, actually, to do my prayers, Asr pray, Maghrib pray, and Isha pray. It's a nice, friendly place. Everyone's really friendly. We've got the young people now, you know, starting to come in. Usually it's elderly people, but they're starting to get the young people, which is coming in, which is nice for them to get interacted with their daily prayers and everything. Keeps your mind fresh, away from all the hardships in life. You know, no issues you'll have here. The staff and everything, everyone's really friendly. We have special meetings on the weekdays. Late evenings, we have a special meeting. So if you want to join, though, you're welcome to come and join.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Zakaria, and I'm here right now at the mosque currently here. Alhamdulillah, it's an amazing mosque. I've been here since it was open. They were open only 3 days before Ramadan last year, so it was a really good push. The management tried so hard to get everything ready for the sisters and the brothers. So alhamdulillah, everything is really good. All the Jummas I've been to, it's been amazing. The management always plan correctly. They do 5 daily prayers, so all the prayers are coordinated correctly. They've got an app where you can see all the time, so anybody that doesn't exactly come here all the time, they can look on the app and they can see when the prayers are. So alhamdulillah, everything is really good. So yeah, inshallah, they'll be doing another Ramadan here where they'll be able to access the ground floor. So inshallah, there'll be more space for the brothers and sisters to pray here, along with some water facilities. Jazakallah.
The Wembley Muslim Centre may be lacking in both capacity and facilities. However, the centre allows the congregation of the 5 daily prayers and serves as a hub for fellow Muslims and non-Muslims alike to learn and appreciate Islam and the teachings of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Inshallah, through the grace of Allah, the Wembley Muslim Centre can expand to serve an even greater number of Muslims. Till next time, Assalamu alaikum.